Welcome to IIT Gandhinagar. So, as you all probably have heard by now, there is something that is quite literally making the waves around the world, which is the detection of gravitational waves, one of the predictions of Einstein's general theory of relativity. IIT Gandhinagar is proud to have been a part of this discovery. So the purpose of this general talk is to introduce to you the basics of what this discovery is all about. So today's colloquium is divided into two parts. The first part would be handled by Dr. Sudipta Sarkar, who is an expert on the theory of GR and black holes. So he will give a half an hour presentation on the history of general relativity and the theoretical basics that one would need to understand what this discovery is all about. And the second half of the talk would be handled by Dr. Anand, Sengupta. Anand has been a part of the LIGO collaboration, which was involved in the detection of the gravity waves, and he played a direct part in this discovery. So it's going to be great to get a first person's perspective on what this discovery is all about. There'll be a short break between the two talks, and after Sudipta finishes, we will take a few questions from the audience and then move on to Anand's part. And after that, Dr. Sudhanshu has promised us to entertain us with a few verses of his own. So let's get started with the first part of today's talk and welcome Dr. Sarkar.
Okay, so I don't have a particular plan for this talk, so the idea of what I'm going to do is that I try to explain to you very simply. Okay, so all the experts here will be highly disappointed at the end of my talk, because I'm not going to use any real, you know, mathematics or real art physics argument. The idea is to use very simple argument to tell you why the theory of general relativity considered to be so novel, so important, and why the discovery of general relativity and the gravitational waves are so important. That's the whole idea of this talk. I'm not going to talk about that discovery for one very simple reason, that I don't understand much of this calculations or also the detection part, the laser physics part. So that will be discussed by Anand, my colleagues. So by the way, so November 25th, 2015 was the 100th year of general relativity. That is the formal discovery, the formal publication of Einstein's paper where this equation was formally there. So Einstein wrote several papers on the theory of general relativity, starting from the 1909, 1910, and he wrote several equations. All of them were wrong. It turns out in the 1915, ultimately, in November 25th, he published the right equation. And the consequences of that equation is profound. And even after 100 years, can you imagine that he wrote down one equation, actually 10 equations, after 100 years, the consequence of that equation turns out to be one of the major discoveries in the history of science. That something is unconscionable. So let's start with this. So this is the Times magazine picture, which says that Albert Einstein is the, in some sense, one of the celebrated men of the last century, in the 20th century. And the theory of relativity, both special relativity and general relativity, is considered one of the greatest icons of modern science. And in some sense, it is considered as other things, one of the greatest achievements of human intellect at the level of Sengupta's or the theory of evolution of Darwin, and sometimes even greater than that. What is why it is so? This theory has absolutely almost zero practical application, except correcting few kilometers in each GPS, which is completely insignificant. Okay? Because we could have all lived without GPS, we would have lived without general relativity also. That is not the greatness of this theory. But still, it is considered to be one of the most beautiful physics theories, and in my personal humble opinion, that is the most beautiful physics theory which we know today. So the question is, why it is so important and so beautiful for generation of physicists to pursue for at least 100 years? And how the recent discovery of gravitational wave fits into this beauty, this structural beauty? So for that, we need to travel 400 years in the next 30 minutes, starting from Newton to the days of Einstein and beyond. So let's start with the physics during the time of Mr. Newton. So this is where the Newton's work, the theory of mechanics by Newton, the Newtonian mechanics, which you also call the classical mechanics, okay, is the basis of our engineering, or the day-to-day engineering. And it is one of the first time when we try to be able to understand the laws of nature. So we all know about Newton's theory of gravitation. What is Newton's theory of gravitation? Think if you have two masses separated by a distance d, then the force is proportional to the product of the masses and distance squared. That's all. I have two mass. The force, gravitational force between them is given by this formula, where this g is the Newton's constant. And in our limit system, this Newton's constant is some 10 to the power minus 11 or something. Small. What it means is that, look at this formula. There is no mention of time. It's like, given a mass, there is instantaneously force or another mass. And the magnitude of force will be given by this formula. This experiment does that. It exists very well with all the experiments up till 1901 or 2. Okay. So Newton described gravity as a universal attractive force. It is there everywhere. Everything is acted by it. Okay? There is no way you can change it or stop it or shield it. Unlike electromagnetism, you can shield electromagnetism. You cannot shield gravity. And it is always attractive. There is no negative gravitational mass. There is no repulsion in gravitation. So this is Newton discovering gravity using an apple. All this picture of this static idea of force has changed completely starting from 1905, where Einstein first changed the Newtonian mechanics and derived what is known as the special theory of relativity. So the 1905 is considered to be the wonder years of Einstein. So he published 5 papers. Gravitational motions. For example, each of these papers is worth more than a Nobel Prize. You know what I mean? I hope you understand that worth more than a Nobel Prize. But among all those papers, this particular 2 papers on special relativity is considered to be one of the, it's the special relativity paper, which is called the On the Electrodynamics of Moving Bodies, and it is highly readable actually. It uses all the algebra. Okay. And I strongly suggest if anybody is interested of great physics, look at that paper. It is actually very easy, very beautifully written. So what Einstein shows that the Newtonian mechanics is actually not the right way of looking at the nature. One should think of the nature in terms of the special relativity. And the main idea of special relativity is that there is no notion of absolute time, there is no universal clock, which means the flow of time depends on the choice of the observer. Say for example, I do 2 things, they consider 2 events, A and B. So I see the A happening after B. And think of they don't have much of a causal connection. Okay? So I say A happens after B. Okay? Now this temporal ordering of events in Newton's theory is absent. It means if A happens after B with respect to you, A will happen after B with respect to everybody, which is like our common sense. What Einstein told you, no, this idea of temporal order or the idea of simultaneity that A and B happens together, this depends on the choice of observer. It depends on your state of motion. And this is revolutionary. So let us understand why it is revolutionary. If you follow Einstein's logic in special relativity, it comes on to consequences that he shows. The flow of time is relative, it depends on the choice of observer. And therefore it comes out this amazing phase, which is called moving clocks runs where it's not easy to understand this phase. Every time I teach special relativity, I get confused. Which frame, who is slowing down? Okay. Of course, I make the students also confused, but it means that it is non-trivial. Anybody who has taught special relativity will understand what I'm trying to say. So special relativity completely revised our view about space and time. It says that the notion of time is highly non-trivial and you have to be very careful in understanding the notion of time. There is no universal time as Newton would have thought. Most importantly, special relativity requires that the speed of light in vacuum is universal. It's the maximum velocity, speed for anything to travel. Nothing can move faster than the speed of light. That's like ultimate limit. You cannot do that. You cannot surpass the speed of light. It's a law of nature. Now, how non-trivial is special relativity? When I say something is non-trivial, you will understand how great genius Einstein was. See, it's always easy to do complicated calculation. I have made complicated calculation, and many of you have also done simulations, calculations. I think my phone is. Now, difference comes when you can change something very, very fundamental, very, very simple. What is more simpler than velocity addition theorem? Think of something. You have a red light and a red car and a blue light car. And a red car traveling with the speed V, blue car traveling with the speed U. You would have said the speed of blue car with respect to red car is U minus V. Okay. This is like class 5 mathematics. Arithmetic. Okay. You have a lot. Nothing is more simpler, more fundamental than that. What Einstein did is to change this law, which is like fundamentally changing our understanding of the nature. I hope I will be able to convey this message. This is not something very complicated calculation or very big simulation. It is like changing the very notion, understanding of the basic things. So for example, if I have a light moving at velocity c, according to this law, the velocity of light as seen by this red car would have been u minus less than the velocity of c. Okay, it will be v minus c. Okay, it should make sense. What Einstein says is that no, that is not true. There has to be a new law of addition. So he said, if two objects are traveling with velocities u and v, this is their relative velocity. In your childhood, you have ignored this factor simply because this c is the speed of light, which is so large that this factor is almost equivalent to zero for ordinary cases, when u and v are ordinary velocities. And 50 km, 200 km per second or something, even then. So basically, if you use this formula, you can show if the light is moving with respect to velocity c in its own film, if that such a thing exists, then with respect to this car also, light will move with the velocity c. The speed of light will be the same for everyone. This is like changing the class 5 arithmetic book. There is no such great thing beyond this. That's why Einstein is considered to be so genius. And this Einstein was very happy after changing Newton. And this is Newton who is very angry after knowing that Einstein has changed his law. So basically, Einstein becomes a celebrity overnight. So the conjecture is partly because of his hair. I don't know. So people have conjectured why suddenly Einstein, just after 1915, becomes so much celebrated. But the history of scientists, in fact, it's a very interesting question in the history of science. Why just after special relativity? He becomes so famous. There are a lot of interesting conjecture. But the story is not yet over. The special relativity introduced more paradoxes than its result. So he modified mechanics proposed by Galileo and Newton. And for example, he said the velocity addition rule is no longer valid. But what about the Newton's theory of gravity? That is not yet touched. So one has to Newton. So special relativity is something supreme. It says that nothing can move faster. So can you make your Newton's theory of gravity consistent with special relativity? So you ask this question. Suppose you have sun, you have earth. So light takes about 8 minutes to go from sun to earth. Okay. Now suppose you disturb the sun. The news of the disturbance of the gravitational field of sun, how long it will take to reach the earth? Remember that Newton's formula, F equal to gmm by c squared, there's no time in it. So according to Newton, if you disturb it at 2 o'clock, the news of disturbance will reach here at 2 o'clock. It will be instantaneous news about the gravity coming to the Earth from the Sun. But that will violate the fundamental of the special relativity. The special relativity says nothing can move faster than that. So somehow you have to introduce this notion of time into the Newton's theory. So light takes about 8 minutes to travel from sun to earth. The question is, what would that? How long it takes for gravity to come, or the disturbance of the gravitational force of sun from coming from sun to earth? That's the question to be asked. And it is indeed a very, very difficult question. It's not easy to understand that. So it took Einstein almost 10 years to obtain the final form of the theory. He has went through so much jig-jag path. He even wrote papers which are mathematically wrong. And has to be because he's traveling a path which nobody has ever traveled. For example, he had learned mathematics which at that time physicists can even dream of. Okay. For example, Professor Puri can tell you better. In 1920s, when Heisenberg was doing quantum mechanics, it turns out physicists didn't even know what is matrix. What is matrix multiplication? Einstein taught himself, with the help of his other mathematics colleagues, differential geometry, which even today is not a very standard, mathematics thing for physicists. And my colleagues here, maths colleagues will strongly disagree that physicists understand differential equations. But I should learn it and used it and actually contributed in it. Okay. Beyond that. So what is this theory of general relativity? Of course, it takes 2 semester course to understand it. I'll give you in 3 seconds. In special general relativity, gravity is not a force. What is to be understood is that it's a property of space-time outside the object. So in some sense, what happens, the presence of the sun changes something in the surrounding structure of space-time. How the light travels, how the time flows, all these things that change. And as a result, we see a kind of a, I would say, it looks like as if there is a force acting on the Earth. But there is no force, it's just the background in which Earth is moving has been changed from flat to curved. So in Einsteinian language, gravity is nothing but the manifestation of the curvature of space-time. So gravity affects what is called my favorite term, because the causal structure of space-time. How do events are causally related? That gets changed because of the presence of gravity. The flow of time gets affected by the presence of gravity. The motion of light gets affected because of the motion of gravity. The gravity changes the very notion of time and space. So I have to show you this because this is what I use for my livelihood, my bread and butter, my job also. This is what is called the Einstein's equation. There's absolutely no need to go into the details. But what is this is relating matter with geometry. So up to this part, any differential geometer knows better than the physicist. This part was known even before Einstein. At least not in his language, but it was known. This is matter and this is geometry. In one go, Einstein put this equality sign. This is probably one of the greatest achievements after Newton, putting this equality sign. Relating the notion of geometry, space-time geometry, with that of matter. Matter determines the geometry. The half of the Einstein theory is this. So, let me show you the difference between Einstein and Newton. So, if you ask Newton that why Earth moves around the sun, Newton would have said, there's a force between sun and Earth. And as I said, Einstein would have said, the space-time surrounding our sun is no longer flat, the space-time is now curved, and poor Earth is just following the curved path. It looks like as if there is a force. Earth has no option but to follow that curve. But there is no force. And who is light? There is overwhelming evidence in favor of Einstein. For example, I talk about Anand will talk about some more, and of course the gravitational waves. So let me talk about something called bending of light. According to Einstein, so suppose there is a sun. Einstein said presence of the gravity will change the flow of light. So if this light was actually coming from here, it will bend because of the presence of sun and it will come to here, to Earth. So the gravity will act like a lens. This is what happens when you have a convex lens. It's a gravitational lens. So the apparent position of the sun will be here. Okay. Sorry, the apparent position of that particular star will be here. And you can actually calculate by solving Einstein's equation, what is this angle? And that angle turns out to be some 1.75 of arc seconds. And there's an experiment done in 1919, I think, by a British astronomer, Arthur Eddington, that result exactly matches with the general relativity results. This cannot be explained by Newton's theory. First of all, it's very difficult to understand in Newton's theory what do you mean by bending of a wave by gravitational field. If light is a particle, probably still you can understand it, then also you will get half of this result, not the full result. And this is a picture from Hubble Space Telescope. As you can see, there's a bright spot and you can see several arcs in this picture. This is a picture of a very deep field of the sky. Each of these lights are a distant galaxy. What you're looking at a picture is some billions of years old, because light takes billions of years to come here. So many of these lights are actually not genuine galaxies, but they're just like images, gravitational lensing images. And in fact, this ring was predicted by Einstein. You can see there's a ring if you can see it. This is called the Einstein's ring in the literature. So this is one of the major verifications of the Einstein theory of relativity. So a light exactly behaves exactly the way Einstein told it to behave. Now comes the part of the important part that today's talk is based on this gravitational wave. So where does this gravitational wave fit in? So as I told you, in Newton's theory, there was no time. Okay, gravitational force is instantaneous between two points. Einstein understood, no, gravitational disturbance takes a finite time. It travels at the speed of light to reach. It takes a lifetime for gravity to move. So let us consider the example of an electromagnetic wave. So what is electromagnetic wave? All of you know about this. So suppose you have a charged body. You have a static field, which goes as 1 by r squared. Oh, you all know the static field. So if you integrate over large distances, the amplitude will fall by 1 by r to the power 4. If you integrate over large distances, the effect of the field goes to 0, as distances goes to infinity. So that means, if there is a charge, there is no information about that presence of the charge at infinity. The Coulomb force goes to 0. Now what you do is that you shake the charge. That emits electromagnetic field. That means, there is a part of the field which falls off as 1 by r. This is, in our physics language, we call it the radiating part. Because this fall off is not 1 by r squared, rather 1 by r, even at infinity, if you integrate over a sphere, even at infinity, there is an information about the presence of these fluctuations. That is what you call the radiating part of the field. This is the basis of the electromagnetic field theory, by which you can send information about the change of the charge here to there. You can transfer energy in front of wave. Electromagnetic waves travel at the speed of light in vacuum. According to Einstein, the disturbance of the gravitational field travel exactly at the speed of light, similar to the electromagnetic wave, as a ripple in space. So you have a mass, you shake the mass, gravitational waves created, and you have a radiating gravitational field also at 1 by r. But the angular distribution is far more complicated. There is no dipole component, there is only quadrupole component, all blah blah blah. More than the concept is actually this. So I should do a bit of shameless self-promotion, if you allow me to do. So it turns out this fact that disturbance of gravitational field travels at the speed of light is a telltale sign of general relativity. So if you add corrections to general relativity, today we believe a lot that general relativity may not be the final theory, there may be corrections to general relativity, then this fact will change. For example, you can create a fictional theory in which the gravitational field travels differently than light. And this is what I've been studying, and this is, of course, once we got this gravitational wave result, we thought that even our fictional theory, we can write a paper. And this is what we are doing. So basically, this could be a telltale sign to distinguish general relativity and to understand the physics beyond general relativity. So for example, in this gravitational wave signature, if you actually see that the speed of gravitational wave are a bit less than the speed of light, I would have claimed, look, give me Nobel Prize, because I can tell you that this is a difference between, this is because the general relativity equations needs correction. Of course, this is what we all do. This is just what you can form. Okay. So electromagnetic wave carries energy. Gravitational waves also carries energy. Of course, the angular distribution of energy is different from the electromagnetic wave, but it does carry energy. So if you have black holes, suppose take two stars. When two stars move, there's a disturbance. Gravitational waves carry energy out of this system. So what will happen? They lose energy. They will come close to each other and they will collapse. So what will happen? As the waves take away energy, the time period of rotation will decrease. Because they are moving closer to each other, the speed is increasing. So you can actually look at, so for example, if you can follow one of the stars, you can actually calculate what is the change, decrease of time period with time. So suppose you can look at the stars, and there are certain stars called pulsars, which you can use to measure time period very accurately because of their some particular property. So you can look at two binary pulsars and see how their time period is decreasing with time, and then compare it with the prediction of general relativity. And here is the comparison. This is the change of time period, cumulative time period shift. So this would have been zero if there is no gravitational wave. This is non-zero means time period is changing because there is something taking away energy from the system. And this is over time, so you see that this is some 30 years of observation. And this is the solid line is a prediction of general relativity, and red line, red dots, at experimental level. This shows that either this is fabricated or Einstein is God. One of them must be true. This is Hulse and Taylor, this leads to Nobel Prize. This is the indirect evidence of gravitational wave. This is not a direct evidence. We are not seeing the waves. What you are saying is that the energy loss because of the emission of the waves. So if these physicists, when they saw it, they were almost sure that this has to be due to the gravitational wave. But still, what is required? We need to see them directly, these waves, which are responsible for this energy loss. Because they will have information about the system. In fact, so let me tell you a bit of history. The Einstein never believed in the gravitational wave, existence of gravitational wave. Because, you know, general relativity is a very complicated theory. There's this question, which things are gauge dependent, which things are coordinate dependent. And Einstein actually thought the gravitational waves could be coordinate dependent object. So then it just doesn't exist. So he has this famous quotation. Together with a young collaborator, this guy's name is Rosen, he's a Soviet physicist at that time, very brilliant, right? I arrived at the interesting result that gravitational waves do not exist. This is what Einstein is writing in 1936. He himself didn't understand general relativity. So when Bharat says that I am an expert of general relativity, you know what? He said, this shows that non-linear general relativistic field equation can tell us more, rather limit us if you believe it up to now. So he said that gravitational wave doesn't exist. He wrote down this paper, he submitted to physical review. Okay, good people submit their paper to physical review. Okay. Okay, and got rejected. The paper got rejected. And it takes a guts to reject Einstein's paper. Okay, of course, the referee was anonymous. And then Einstein wrote this reply. He said, dear sir, to the editor, I said your manuscript for publication is not authorized you to show it to specialists before it is printed. I see no reason to address, in case of anonymous, the comments of your anonymous expert. So he said, I prefer to publish this paper elsewhere. I cannot write this, of course Einstein can. Okay. And he decided that he will not publish anything in physical review anymore. But Einstein was wrong. And you know who is the referee to this? This is Robertson, the referee. And hats off to him. Of course, Einstein was explained that he himself didn't understand general relativity by several of his colleagues, like Infield, of course Robertson, and many other people. And he convinced that about that, accepted the existence of general relativity long in the 50s, not before that. Even 20 years, he didn't believe that gravitational wave are actually true in general relativity. In fact, unfortunately, or fortunately, it was a quantum physicist who convinced the GR community. See, in those days, even today actually, general GR community has a very healthy attitude towards, you know, people who do quantum field theory. Okay. Because quantum field theory is done, at least was those days, done in a language which is not very aligned to the classical language of physics, but a standard language of the physics. But interestingly, in one of the GR conferences, these are famous conferences which takes place every 3 years, and where very beautiful discussion takes place. Feynman, who attended this conference, who understood general relativity, and he convinced the GR guys, look boss, most of you are wrong. I give an argument where gravitational waves are actually real. And he gives a typical argument that you can use gravitational wave to light up matchsticks. So that means if you can use it to create a ball, for example, electromagnetic wave, you can use to heat it up something, or even kill people by electromagnetic waves. That means they are really real, okay? Nothing is more real than that. Feynman gave a conclusive argument that you can use gravitational waves to detect things. But that doesn't mean that they exist. You have to prove it experimentally. At the end of the day, physics is experimental science. And also, just because I can see the existence of gravitational wave, that doesn't mean I can calculate the gravitational wave. Because Einstein's equations are extremely complicated. To know how the gravitational wave will look like, it took almost 70 years. When ultimately, when the supercomputers came, okay, and then people like Anand came into business, throw away people like us who doesn't know computers very well, and they come up with the result. So, for example, I'll talk about this guy, G.V. Vicious. I'm sorry I couldn't able to put a picture because of this internet problem, but let me tell you somebody about Professor Vicious, who visited here actually. He's the person who part of the black holes. So basically, the question is that if you have a black hole, if you part of it, gravitational waves will come out of it. But how do you know how the waves will look like? That calculation is what Sri Vicious for the first time who did this calculation and shown to the world how the gravitational waves from black holes will look like. And this is what is called the famous quasi-normal modes calculation. Okay. There's another guy, A.K. Rai Choudhury, who's this famous equation. Of course, I'm not going to give you, this equation is very difficult to explain. This equation explained that this black, so this is what I call the man who looked into the black hole. So the idea of this slide is to show you there's a consistent culture of contribution to the theory of relativity from India. Because it came from mostly mathematics side, and slowly the physicist side also catch up, okay? So for example, Rajendra's equation is so important, this is the basis of our modern black hole physics. If you open any book on modern black hole physics, this starts with Rajendra's equation. Professor P.C. Vaidya, so in general relativity, it's very difficult to write down black hole solutions. We only know few, maybe two, three, okay, if you think of it. There's one caused by Schwarzschild. There's only one time-dependent black hole solution. This mathematicians can understand. This is simply a pseudo-Riemannian matrix. That is what I mean by black hole solution. There's only one time-dependent black hole solution, where black holes are actually evolving in time by eating matter out of it. That scenario has been first described by P.C. Vaidya. It's from here. Was a VC in Gujarat University, a very celebrated general relativist. That is what is called the Vaidya black hole. And in fact, the solution is used extensively for studying various properties of black hole, both classical and quantum properties of black hole. It's an amazing achievement. So this is a cumulative effort of several great minds. Okay? Ultimately led to this picture for black holes coming from gravitational waves coming from black holes. This should be, so Anand will explain you this picture. But think of it, this is like a theoretical wave, of course. It is a theory, take it. Okay, I will object it a bit, but I'll just give you a little bit of lies, okay? It is the theoretical template. I think that is the right way of looking at it. It's a template. So this is what theorists told you. The gravitational wave from black holes should look like. And this is what people like Anand find. Look at it. Such a complicated system coming from billions of years, light years away. So many complexities involved. The power of the theory and power is almost the same. And this reminds me one of the very beautiful statements by Einstein that the most incomprehensible thing about the universe that it is comprehensible. The fact that we can actually predict and calculate things and we can see the nature obeying our calculation gives us immense confidence in the power of science or the scientific methodology. That, I think, is a very important thing to take away from this result. And I leave this to Anand. Thank you. Slowly, the physicist side also catch up, okay? So, for example, Rajendra's equation is so important. This is the basis of our modern black hole physics. If you open any book on modern black hole physics, it starts with Rajendra's equation. Professor P.C. Vaidya, so in general relativity, it's very difficult to write down black hole solutions. We only know few, maybe two, three, okay, if you think of it. There's one caused by Schwarzschild. There's only one time-dependent black hole solution. This mathematicians can understand. This is simply a pseudo-Riemannian matrix. That is what I mean by black hole solution. There's only one time-dependent black hole solution, where black holes are actually evolving in time by eating matter out of it. That scenario has been first described by P.C. Vaidya. It's from here. Was a VC in Gujarat University, a very celebrated general relativist. That is what is called the Vaidya black hole. And in fact, the solution is used extensively for studying various properties of black hole, both classical and quantum properties of black hole. It's an amazing achievement. So this is a cumulative effort of several great minds. Okay? Ultimately led to this picture for black holes coming from gravitational waves coming from black holes. This should be, so Anand will explain you this picture, but think of it, this is like a theoretical wave, of course. Okay. It is a theory, take it. Okay, Anand will object it a bit, but I'll just give you a little bit of lies, okay? It is the theoretical template. I think that is the right way of looking at it, it's a template. So this is what theorists told you. The gravitational wave from black holes should look like. And this is what people like Anand find. Look at it. Such a complicated system coming from billions of years, light years away. So many complexities involved. The power of the theory and power is almost the same. And this reminds me one of the very beautiful statements by Einstein that the most incomprehensible thing about the universe that it is comprehensible. The fact that we can actually predict and calculate things. And we can see that nature obeying our calculation gives us immense confidence in the power of science or the scientific methodology. That, I think, is a very important thing to take away from this result. And I leave this to Anand. Thank you.
So, any quick questions for Dipto? We have about 5 minutes for questions.
The lecture has been very interesting. You know, I have a question, like there is something like quantum entanglement. So, because I am not exactly from your the physics side, being an engineer, and then my area is nanoelectronics, I work with quantum devices. So what does Einstein say about that?
Okay, that's a very good guy. I think there is an expert here who can talk about it. So entanglement is a, you know, in some sense the quantumness, okay, in some sense the, it's a telltale sign of the presence of quantum properties. Einstein, so you know the famous EPR paradox, which of course the hallmark of Einstein's, another part of the geniusness, which he used the entangled line to argue against the quantum theory. But of course we understand that Einstein has this classical bias looking at the physics. But instead of talking about Einstein, let me tell you a bit about one-liner, about this present understanding, the current picture for balance. If you look at from the theory of quantum gravity, from the string theory point of view, today we believe the entanglement, quantum theory, the entanglement quantum theory can have a meaning in terms of black holes. What they believe is that there are two black hole-like solutions connected by what is called a wormhole. It's a geometric picture, what you have called two bits connected by entanglement. So today, there is this new picture coming out of the string theory, the ACFT, where this entanglement in the quantum theory has a geometric meaning. And if it is true, it will be another revolution. Actually, it is amazing.
They are contradictory, right? I mean, what the theory is because entanglement is a time thing.
No, there is actually no contradiction of theory of entanglement with the special relativity. The locality principles are perfect. So there is this apparent contradiction, but if you look at deeply, there is no contradiction. This leads to all this Bell inequality and so many things.
All right. Any other quick question pertaining to JR?
So just one quick question in relation to that. I'm not a physicist. I never studied physics ever. But if you could allow some layman's questions in this way. As she says that quantum entanglement, it says that if one electron has this spin and another opposite, if I can have this kind of a inverse apart, if I change one spin, other spin gets changed instantaneously, does it mean that information
No, it doesn't. So I'll give you which person to ask, Professor Puri.
So let's keep entanglement question separately and let's restrict this for the lay of gravity. So I will allow one more question. Students?
Just a quick question. The last figure that you showed. What does it tell you?
Which figure?
The very last figure that you
showed. It tells a lot.
Okay, so that's the subject of Anand's talk. So that's
it tells a lot.
Okay.
Just one minute, which I have to say. Sorry. Even the existence of this part shows that there are black holes in nature. Conclusive evidence. This tells sign, this.
What's the x axis?
So this is, okay, Anand will explain. This is the, I'll leave it to Anand because I have to then talk about a lot of things.
So many times when we refer to the space-time fabric and the photo that you showed about the sun, it's almost imagined as a 2D fabric. But if we imagine as a like complete whole dimension fabric, then don't you think gravitational waves will be obstructed by the fabric itself?
No, that is because, that's a good question. That is because, I'm sorry, this entire picture, what I showed is complete fraud. This is just a two-dimensional way of looking at things. So this is what would have happened if there is a two-dimensional curvature. But space-time is a four-dimensional manifold. So the curvature, what I'm talking about, is a curvature of the four-dimensional manifold. You can actually think of it as a something embedded in a five-dimensional object. If you think of this sheet as five to four-dimensional, then from the five-dimensional world, this will look like this. Okay, this is what then you would have called an embedded diagram. So gravitational waves actually travel in spacetime, not in space. So they evolve in spacetime. So there is no such thing like obstruction or anything.
Alright, so let's stop with the first half of the talk and let's now invite Anand to give us the actual detection part.
Colleagues, friends, students, especially colleagues from nearby institutes, it's a great pleasure to announce that, of course, you already know it, and that we discovered the first gravitational wave signals from binary black holes. It's great, apart from the name, it will not be that interesting. If you really wanted to call it, you would have called it something really big. But this basically is it alludes to the fact that it was discovered in 2015. 09 is the month, September. So it was discovered on 14th of September 2015. So that's why it was that name. So what I plan to do in this short presentation is to basically introduce you to this object and also answer partly what Mukesh was asking, what exactly do you learn from this? And it turns out a whole lot. So as Sudipta has said the same for things, so you have a geometric theory of gravity from Einstein. Where the space-time curvature is basically equated to mass and energy. And then whenever this mass and energy undergo some dynamics, basically there is a time-varying curvature which travels out as a wave through space-time. And that is what you're seeing. This is what I call, or what we call gravitational wave. So that is your 3-second introduction to what it is. And this is not the first test, of course, just to put things in context, this is not the first test that Einstein's theory had to go through. It has been put through many tests in the past, and it has always passed with flying colors. For instance, I'll show you a couple of them. So one effect that this new theory of gravity, the geometric theory of gravity has, is that planets don't trace the same path, although they do trace ellipses around the sun. It turns out that when these planets, when the effects of general relativity are strong, then they don't trace exactly the same path in every orbit. So between one orbit and the next, they move a little bit. So the ellipses change their orientation a little bit. And that is known technically as the perihelion advance of Mercury. Mercury being the closest planet to the Sun shows the most effect. But even then, it's a tiny thing to measure. It's 43 seconds of arc in a century. So you know, there have been jobless people looking at Mercury for 7 years and noting down that position. That was all they were doing. And apart from being a curiosity, nobody really bothered. Okay, fine. So it changes a little bit. Except that you can actually explain it through general relativity. And that was one of the first earliest cases where this guy passed with flying colors. The fact that planets go around as ellipses was already known by Newtonian theory of gravity. Really much more than that, explain it. But this little curiosity, kind of very nice. Okay. So then, I will not talk about gravitational redshift because it will take away from what I really want to do in the next half an hour. But students, if you really want to look up Google or Wikipedia, that's the keyword that you should look up. There's another thing that Sudipta also mentioned. Another test that Einstein's gravity actually passed with flying colors, and that was explaining images which showed the deflection of light from distant galaxies. So basically, you have light from distant galaxies. I'll have a picture of that. I'll show that in slightly more detail. And one little quip about the fact that general relativity is actually closer than you think. So every time you use GPS navigation, the whole colloquium, you would actually use in general relativity in a very, very real sense. So here is what one of the tests that I was talking about. So here is Mercury going around the Sun. And every time it goes around the Sun, it does go, you know, in an elliptical orbit. Except that this ellipse moves around a little bit. And the closest position of Mercury to Sun is called the perihelion. Okay? And this, the position of the perihelion in subsequent orbits, so orbit number 1, 2, 3, 4, and you see that this perihelion is advancing. Okay? So the first orbit is this, and the second orbit is slightly away from that, so the perihelion has advanced, and so on. And as I said, people had observed this for many years, and they found that 43 seconds of an hour in 100 years. Very tiny effect. When this theory came along, it fit very well. This is actually, you calculate how much it would be and fit very well. So that was one. The second was, I don't think there is enough contrast to view this image properly. So what you have is a very heavy object, maybe a black hole in some host galaxies. The centers of all galaxies have a very massive black hole. And there is a distant galaxy. So this is Earth, and you're looking at this distant galaxy. And what will happen is because of the curvature in space-time caused by this massive object here, the light from the distant galaxy will get curved like that. And then what you will see through a telescope is, of course, this quasar, which is shining very bright, not because the black hole is emitting a lot of light, but because the gas that is falling into the black hole, is emitting a lot of radiation. Because it is getting accelerated, these are charged particles, so if they accelerate, they emit a lot of radiation. That's what you see. And then symmetrically placed images of this distant galaxy. And that's how you know that the light has bent around that object. So all those things, among other things, Einstein's gravity also predicts very exotic things like black holes. And this is an image of looking at the center of our own galaxy, so Sagittarius A, and looking at the motion of the stars. And just to give you a sense of how the scales, this little bar here denotes 10 light days. And I'd like to play this. This is actual data, which is not playing. Here, it denotes just time. So, it's from, year in years. And then you're zooming in, and then what happens? So there's nothing here, absolute darkness. And look at the track of these stars. You see, these stars are, going around something. So if you just assume, so there must be some mass here, which is just gravitationally interacting with that mass and taking on these trajectories. And from these trajectories, you can work out the mass of this object, which you cannot see. And it works out to be something of a million solar mass. Okay? If it's a million solar mass, then that's a problem. Because something as tiny as this hiding a million solar mass, what would it be? So, Einstein's theory predicts black holes. Let me just get back to my slides. It also predicts that when black holes merge, they generate gravitational waves. And that is what we are going to see here. And the whole aim is to see that slightly more closely. So black holes, if they occur as a binary, they are gravitationally bound, and then they go around each other, and as we expect, they emit gravitational waves. Except, and that part of the evolution is very well known to theory, and that a lot of Indian contribution has come in, has been put in behind this understanding, this part of the evolution. Except that when they come very close, they start merging, and then that part was not well known analytical calculations, and one needed a numerical relativity to get this part right. But then once they had merged, people knew very well what the expected waveforms from these black holes would be once these two black holes had merged. And that was Professor Vishweshwara's work. And I think ABV would be very happy here, because, and also sir, I think they would be really happy related to Vishweshwara. And what we saw on 14 September 2015 was a little part of this, and a lot of this, and then again a little part of this. And I'll show you exactly what it is. So, this is a little simulation which was done by the Rochester group, which shows that what happens when two objects, two black holes merge, and this is actually taking the same parameters as the one that we discovered. So you see, these colors are basically showing curvature, so they are color-coded by the curvature, and you see two black holes, one slightly bigger than the other, which are gravitationally bound, they are losing angular momentum and energy to gravitational waves, and therefore they are coming closer. And then this movie will be slowed down when the merger happens, so that you can appreciate what really goes on. And there you see, so it has been slowed down. You can see that they are under the, you know, they are going through a merger to form one central object. There you go. Frozen. And this object will basically ring down, it will lose all its energy. There you go. And you cannot see it spinning except, I mean, this movie is available on all our sites, on the Indigo site as well as the LIGO Scientific Collaboration sites. So if you wanted to take a closer look, all you have to do is just Google this up. So basically, that is what we hope to see. But that was not the first time, I mean, that, of course, that would be a direct detection to measure gravitational waves, that would be really great. But as Sudipta again pointed out, that we already had an indirect evidence that gravitational waves exist, and that was through the observation of this particular system of binary pulsars. Pulsars, as you know, are highly magnetized and very quickly rotating, very fast rotating neutron stars. And again, just like you had in the case for Mercury, whose perihelion advances, but very slowly because the gravitational effects are not very strong. But this system, it could be really very, you know, you can observe it very well. So its perihelion advances 4.2 degrees per year. So one other point that I wanted to mention here is that, of course, you observe the spin rate of this object. So how fast it takes to go around as a function of the year of the time, and you see that it is spinning faster. The fact that it's, you know, the rate, the period decreases means that it is rotating faster, and that's what you saw in the simulation as well. And we are all too used to seeing fits in all our papers. Just wanted to mention that this is not a fit of any kind. Okay, this is not a fit, this is a prediction from general relativity, and of course the initial days where, you know, the data quality may not have been that great, but later on you see that it lies bang on. In fact, the error bars have been blown up so that you can actually see the box. It's that big. Okay? And of course that fetched Hulse and Taylor the Nobel Prize for making this come true. And so what our aim is to basically detect. So why is this an indirect detection of gravitational waves? Because what we are looking at is this system through radio telescope. So we are not looking at the gravitational waves themselves, but we are looking at an object which is emitting gravitational waves, and we are looking at it through the radio spectrum and inferring in some way from their dynamics that they must be emitting gravitational waves. Now what we aim to do in the last 30, 40 years, is to build giant detectors like these. And I'll come to this part in slightly more detail, but just to give you a sense of what the detector scale is, these are 4 kilometers each. This is, if you've seen a Michelson interferometer in college or school, you know that it's basically an L-shaped configuration with light shining in the two perpendicular arms. So there are your perpendicular arms for you. Each arm is 4 kilometers. So it's a huge detector. And what we saw was this. Okay? This is what we saw on 14th September 2015. And we detected the gravitational waves from two black holes that were orbiting each other, and then they finally merged and formed one giant black hole. So that is what we saw. The top frame here, so we saw it in two detectors that were located about 10 milliseconds of light travel between them, about 3,000 kilometers. One located in the northwest part of the United States, in Washington State, and the other one located in Louisiana, which is in the southeast, I mean, roughly speaking. This is the data stream in the two detectors. This is the reconstructed waveform. Unfortunately, the resolution is not good enough for you to see that there is a numerical relativity waveform overlaid on top of that. And then there are other ways of not assuming anything about the waveform and then trying to extract it and so on. All of them are very, very consistent. And when you subtract off what you think is a gravitational wave from the data stream, then this is what you get. The x-axis is time. And the y-axis is strain. Strain is a dimensionless quantity. It is the change in the length of the arms of the interferometer divided by the length of the arm itself. And the units here are 10 to the minus 21. So the unsaid story here, and which I would like to point out, because there are a lot of engineering students in this room, is that as much as it is a miracle in terms of, you know, as much as it is an achievement for physics and mathematics, the detector itself is an engineering one. Okay? So, the developments of many branches of engineering have made it possible to build such a detector, especially material science, mechanical engineering, and electrical engineering. I will mention these three branches in particular, without which measuring such strains are just not possible. In fact, just to drive home another point, I mean, measuring distances, whether small or large, whether on the astrophysical scale or on the, you know, tiny scales like this, have always somehow been related to Nobel Prizes. I know at least one other case where measuring astrophysical distances has fetched somebody Nobel Prize. Let us see what happens to this. So when you subtract off the signal, what you think is the signal from the data, then the residual is completely consistent with noise. And that's this is what is shown over here, that it is completely consistent with noise. If you follow what we detected in time and frequency, so these blobs that you see are basically blobs of energy in time and frequency. And you see that it has a telltale chirp. It's a sweep up of frequency as you go ahead in time. So it's a telltale chirp with more energy deposited as you go forward in time. And this again is represent, is evidence for the fact that these are in fact from the merger of two binary black holes. Looking at it in a slightly different way, I think you had this brought up. So what you're seeing here is the agreement between numerical relativity, which is this red line over here, and which is basically the reconstructed the waveform that you expect from solving Einstein's equations very well from the data. So that is important. Okay? And on top of that, this band of the gray colored band that you see here is basically the reconstructed signal from the data in the two detectors. Okay? So you see that this fantastic agreement near this part, where the error bars are very small, but as you go, to the earlier parts of the spiral, the evolution of this binary, the signal to noise ratio is not that great. So therefore, the errors are large, but still very, very consistent with the spiral signal. telescope tells you how fast these objects were moving when they slammed into each other and created that, you know, burst of gravitational waves around the spot. And you see that at the time of merger, and that is where this curve stops, they were traveling at more than half the speed of light. So imagine two objects, which roughly, each of them roughly 30 times the mass of the sun, traveling at the speed of light, slamming into each other, that ought to create a lot of disturbance in space-time. And this black line is tracing the separation between the two black holes. So as you go in time, these start coming closer and closer, and that's what you see here. They're coming closer and closer until they merge. And beyond the merger, of course, on these, you are unable to calculate these things very well. So that's why all this stops. So that is what we saw, and now I want to tell you what we heard. And why do I say that's what we heard? Because it's not as if the strain had been large and we would have heard it ourselves. And that's just kind of extending the whole analogy a little bit. If you look at the frequencies in which this energy came, this reflection was made, you'll see that they fall right within the audible band of frequencies. From 30 hertz all the way up to about 250 hertz when the actual merger happened. And this is the waveform which when converted into audio amplified was amazing for that. The waveform lasted for about 200 milliseconds. And it arrived in one detector about 7 milliseconds earlier than the other, which was completely consistent with the light travel time of the two detectors. So you expect that if it is genuinely an astrophysical phenomena, it could arrive in one detector slightly earlier or later than the other. And it should not be more than the light travel time between these two detectors. It would be genuinely relatively weaker. Right. Further, of course, now this is the money plot. This is where you show that you have actually detected something. The tagline is, we detected it unambiguously. What it means is that the false alarm rate at the detection level was 1 in 200,000 years. Which means, in other words, and one way to put it is that it would take, you'd have had to collect data for 200,000 years to come up with an event as significant as the one that we saw. So the chance that it was caused by noise alone, or noise masquerading as a signal, was absolutely tiny. And this plot shows our background here. Two types of background plots have been made. So one with the signal put in, and then with this. So this is our detection here. This is GW150914. The x-axis is basically the detection statistic. So this, we saw this event at a signal to noise ratio of about 24. The detection statistic of this event is about 24. This is the coherence statistic. What you see here are the estimates of background. And when I say 5.1 sigma, I basically indicate the farthest signal to noise ratio where I could have made an estimate of the signal. I could have made an estimate of the background. This event is so loud that there was not enough data to make a very, so it was lower than the loudest false alarm that we saw. So had this event occurred at the signal to noise ratio of 14, I would have claimed a 5.1 sigma detection, but it occurred at a signal to noise ratio of 24. Extend this downward somewhere here, it's a very strong statement that I'm making here. would be somewhere around 15 to 20 sigma, maybe, if you think about it.
Yeah, yeah.
So, the question now becomes, to answer some of your questions, what do we learn from this? Well, okay, we detected it, so is there something that you can find out? Turns out that these are what are called standard candles. Standard candles, as in black holes, are very simple. Sense. Why? Because if you just specify its mass, its spin, and its charge, it's completely determined. It's simpler than somebody put it, it's simpler than your cup of coffee. Highly microscopic objects. Charge we don't consider because you know you would have to have a very weird mechanism of pulling all, you know, a lot of charge and putting on a black hole. So mass and spin it is. Now what you do is you track the frequency evolution of how the energy was deposited over time. Okay? So this is one detector and this is the other detector. And just from this shape, you can figure out the masses of these two black holes, which must have merged. And we found that they were 36 and 29 times the mass of the Sun. That much. Just from the last little bit, let me go back, the last little bit which they bring down, it's basically a damped sinusoid, exponentially damped sinusoid. You can fit a damped sinusoid to the last few cycles and figure out the central frequency at which it is ringing down and also the quality factor. Quality factor is how is the energy being? So it's a measure of how fast the energy is dissipated from a system. It's like a bell. If you hit it, if the bell has a very high quality factor, it rings for longer. And so from these two, they are related to the mass of the final black hole and the spin of the final black hole. And that's exactly what one does. And when you do that, you find that the final curved black hole has a mass that is 62 times the mass of the Sun, and it is spinning at about 70% of the maximum that it can. Now, we can also make estimates of the spin of the individual black holes that slammed into each other. But those estimates are not that great. And the reason is, from the waveform itself, you can see that, if these initial, the black holes have spin, what happens is they kind of modulate the waveform. And the effect of the spins of the individual black holes should occur basically in the inspiring one. Because that is where you know they exist as individual black holes. And there are not enough cycles in band to basically make that estimate very well. So therefore, although we do have estimates of the spin of the individual black holes with slamming into each other, those estimates are not that great. However, we can estimate the distance quite well. How do we estimate the distance? As I said, these are standard candles. That means, once I know their masses and spin, I can basically calculate very well how much energy they would have emitted. Okay, so it's like, I know it's 100 watt light bulb. But the amount of energy that I receive on Earth is say a fraction of that. So by just taking these two ratios, I can say how far it must be. That's what we do when we estimate that it must be about 400 megaparsecs from the Earth, which in terms of light years works out to be about 130 crore light years. So very far. This is a figure which is basically the parameter estimation for Sirius of the final mass of the black hole and the final spin of the black hole. And you see that these 1 sigma error bars and the 90% confidence levels are well within the numbers that I measured, that I quoted. So that is what, of course, there are, you know, if you read the companion papers which are going to be out very soon, you will get a whole lot of information, but this is what I thought I should just tell you to get you introduced to this discovery. There are many firsts in this discovery. First of all, this was the direct detection of gravitational waves. We have never done it before, and this was the first. this was the first time you observed the black hole. In fact, you observed two black holes. We never even knew that. Well, of course, it was a known unknown in the sense that people had calculated what would happen if there were such objects. Now that we have seen them, right? It also turns out that this also provided the first test of gravitational waves, or general relativity actually, in strong gravity. Because when you saw the frequency sweep, that frequency sweep has terms, correction terms coming from general relativity, and each term can be measured. And then compared to what we expect from general relativity, and a companion paper on this is coming out soon on archives. So maybe you can just check that out. So the question is then, how do you detect gravitational waves? And this is just a couple of slides I wanted to show, just to drive home the point that there is a lot of opportunity for Indian scientists. Basically, what you need is a very sensitive ruler. Why? Because you are trying to measure strains of this order, 10 to the minus 21, which essentially means you're trying to measure distances accurately to a thousandth of a proton, the size of a proton, over a kilometer. So you should be able to measure 1,000th of the proton's diameter over the length of the detectors, the scale of the detectors. So basically, a very sensitive ruler is basically what you must order. And this is the LIGO detector, at least in schematics, which made this, which is basically that ruler, that sensitive ruler that I'm talking about. So what you have is basically a laser shining into a beam splitter, which then splits the light in 50% along the two arms. And this light goes into this fabricator storage light arm and bounces back several times before coming back. Same on the along this side. So when you have, you know, gravitational waves are incident on this, what happens is, so this is what happens. So if you have a ring of test particles on a circle, and you have gravitational waves incident into the bone, this is what you will expect to see in one of the polarization states of this wave. So basically, alternatively, the perpendicular arms are pushed and stretched. So when that happens, there's a difference in length, and therefore a difference in phase, and then that phase can be read off from the interference patterns that you see over here. So this is a picture of that schematic act in the real picture, where that schematic has been put into operation here, been built in at least two places. Then the third one that is in operation or undergoing upgrades in Virgo, which is a third detector in the French border. Now, if you have multiple detectors, see, these gravitational wave detectors are very unique in the sense that if you have one of them, just one, you wouldn't be very confident about your detection, because there could be noise, and you don't know whether the signal that you're getting is actually from the astrophysical sources. But the other problem is that they are omnidirectional. So their antenna pattern functions are such that it's very hard to pinpoint directions in the sky. You can never say that, it came from that direction. So what you have to do is you have to triangulate. So you have to have multiple detectors to basically triangulate. And in this case, for GW150914, there were two detectors. Now with two detectors, if you try to triangulate, what you basically get is a line. You'll get an arc in the sky. But nevertheless, if nothing else, astronomers they have a lot of time. What they did was they went ahead knowing fully well that they would get a line in the sky. So what? So with two detectors, this is the line that this one. So we now know that this detection that we made came from the southern hemisphere. And this basically comes from the fact that there was a 7-millisecond delay between the arrival of signals in the two detectors and also the antenna pattern part, because everything folded in gives rise to this. Of course, sky is about 0.2 square meters. So it will take a very long time to basically figure out where exactly. So if you wanted to point a telescope, you wouldn't. You'd have to make several thousand, you know, if each pointing was the size of the moon, you would have to take several pointings to basically cover an area which is 590 square degrees in the sky. So nobody did that, of course, but there are collaborators from X-ray and gamma-ray satellite surveys. So some of them have started following this up, and you should stay tuned. There are interesting things to come. So if you find a correlation between some excess in these directions with this event, then that would be another big thing. Of course, it goes without saying that if you have more detectors in this network, then that could improve the location. And that brings me to this slide, which shows that one or two, even two or three is not enough. So these are the two detectors that were used to make this detection. Virgo and Kagra in France, this is Japan, they are coming up. Okay, they are advanced detectors which are being built as we speak. There is a proposed detector called LIGO India, which we hope will come up, because there is a very strong scientific case one can make for such a detector. Why? Because even the two LIGO detectors, you can ask the question, where could I put another detector which would enhance, for instance, which would allow me to locate sources much more accurately? You could ask this question. And if you answer that question, this picture comes up. So what this is showing is the light spots are those places which would be ideal to put a detector. Now the solution to this problem has some symmetry. That's why, in spite of two detectors in the US, this again lights up. But that is the solution which you have to make. So you see that the entire region here, western coast of Australia, southern India, and so on, it's a very good area, except that there's a lot of water in this region, but hardly much land. So that is the reason why India is geographically placed at a very, very important position as far as these, in the network of detectors and doing further astronomy with gravitational waves is concerned. And that's why three institutes, including IPR, they have proposed a LIGO India detector. And our hopes have flown with this tweet that came just 19 minutes into the discovery announcement, saying that hope to move forward to make even bigger contribution with an advanced gravitational wave detector in the country. So I hope this works out, you know. We are all eagerly hoping for the best. Just to give you a sense of where the Indian contributions came from. The Indian contributions came from an umbrella organization called Indigo, which involves these nine institutes. And some of them have started working on, already work on this proposed detector. It took the effort of 1,000 scientists from 16 countries to basically make this detection happen. There are significant Indian contributions to this discovery. Let me just outline a few of them. So basically, a lot of the data analysis framework which made it possible to pull out the signatures of these strange events and look at how to combine data from multiple detectors in order to make a more significant statement about the detection, identifying glitchy data and removing it from the data, all those things were done by a lot of contributions from the Indigo scientists. The other kind of contribution came in the way of calculating post-Newtonian waveforms, even in spiral merge and the complete waveforms and so on. So basically, we contributed to what to expect when you do the data analysis. And more recently, Indigo contributed by working out that the deviations from circular orbits are not measurable at 10 Hertz. So what it means is that when these two black holes, you know, kind of encircled each other and finally merged, these orbits were almost circular. And if they're almost circular, the calculation becomes easier, the
slightly more manageable.
So I'll end by saying that this is just the beginning. This discovery is just the beginning, because now we are bona fide astronomers. We have seen some objects in the sky. We are not just data scientists. We are not theorists. And the other thing is that, good, as Sunita mentioned, good people published in Physical Review D. Anyway, so this is the beginning of gravitational wave astronomy. I think this is very important. This discovery marks the beginning of gravitational wave astronomy. One can do precision cosmology with it, and we can experimentally probe a lot of black hole theorems. Okay, so for instance, black hole thermodynamics is already being probed. The second law of black hole thermodynamics, and there's a paper, you know, which is coming out soon, I hope. LIGO India is on the horizon. That is great news for engineering students, for us, for the entire community actually. A lot of different branches of engineering. We'll be very, very happy that LIGO India is coming up. It has always happened that whenever a new window in the universe has opened up, some unexpected surprises have come up. Okay, so we all are tuned in and we are expecting some unknown unknowns, things that we never expected. So this event that we saw was a known unknown. We knew that it could be. You know, these sources were not completely unexpected, but we are waiting for the known unknowns. So there's a lot to come and there's a lot to contribute. So please stay tuned and you start talking to people so that if you're interested, you can contribute. Thanks, everyone. So just to give you a little, so we have our friend Sudhanshu Sharma here, who started, you know, we were going back to DTC campus and he started talking, and then he was extremely moved by the fact that these signals were coming from 130 crore light year away. So which means that when these signals started traveling towards the first bacterial life form was just beginning to, you know, spread on the planet. And when they came, here we are in this room. So he said that he's a writer, he writes poems, so he thought that, you know, he would like to recite a few verses to my presentation. So here's
hello everyone. So what I was telling him that this is such a big distance, and so what are we? We are nothing. Our lifespan is mostly 100 years and it is crores and crores of years. I don't even know how to count all those things. Then he told me something, and then he said that, and also one interesting fact, that all the elements what we observe in all the periodic table, what we continue to use without even worrying how they came up, they all were born in stars. And it means whatever element, we say that we are the panch tattva. So we are all the sons or daughter of the stars. So with that thought in mind, I tried to write a few lines. While two scientific talks you just heard, everything is well supported by the fact, mathematical expressions. So it made a perfect sense. But what I am telling you today may not make a sense, because I don't need a LIGO detector. I can go to Brahman without even worrying what is happening there. And I don't have to spend any money. So please bear with me, it's in Hindi. So if you want to know the actual meaning, I may not be able to tell you, but later on you can ask me. So the title is Astitva, Existence. Hum kaun hai aur kahan se aaye hain? Hum kaun hai aur kahan se aaye hain? Shaklein alag alag hain, par tattva ek hai. Shaklein alag alag hain, par tattva ek hai. Kehte hain ki hum apne parivar ka hissa hain. Kehte hain ki hum apne parivar ka hissa hain. Parivar sansar ka, और संसार इस धारा का हिस्सा है, परिवार संसार का और संसार इस धारा का हिस्सा है, और ये धारा इस पूरे ब्रह्मांड का हिस्सा है। पर ब्रह्मांड के रहस्य को आगे किसने जाना? पर ब्रह्मांड के रहस्य को आगे किसने जाना जिसमें अनंत आकाश गंगाएं हैं, तारों की अनंत रेखाएं हैं, जिसमें अनंत आकाश गंगाएं हैं, तारों की अनंत रेखाएं हैं, इसी से सृष्टि का हर तत्व बनता है, इसी से सृष्टि का हर तत्व बनता है, इसी के पंच तत्व से मानव जन्म लेता है, इसी के पंच तत्व से मानव जन्म लेता है। तो हम इसी ब्रह्मांड का हिस्सा हैं और इसमें विलीन है, तो हम इसी ब्रह्मांड का हिस्सा है और इसमें विलीन है। ये धरा, ये परिवार, ये सारा संसार अस्तित्वहीन है। ये धरा, ये परिवार और ये सारा संसार अस्तित्वहीन है। इतने अस्तित्वहीन होकर भी अभिमान से जीते आए हैं हम, इतने अस्तित्वहीन होकर भी अभिमान से जीते आए हैं हम, सृष्टि की विशालता को आज तक नकारते आए हैं हम। आज इसके एक रहस्य ने, विच आनंद जस्ट शोड यू, आज इसके एक रहस्य ने हमें हमारी सीमाएं दिखा दी हैं, आज इसके एक रहस्य ने हमें हमारी सीमाएं दिखा दी हैं, और आज हमने भी ब्रह्मांड के आगे अपनी नजरें झुका दी हैं।
So, any questions on Anand's science or Sudipta Sarkar? Yeah.
For Anand. You don't need a mic. I don't need a mic. So, latest science was detected by this advanced lie detector, which is deployed like 6 months, probably, right?
Not 6 months, I mean, okay. So, what is the question that I'm
asking? So, the question is that what is the chances that this signal could also have been detected 30 years ago when you were still looking for it? Was it possible?
That's a very good question. So, the first generation of LIGO detectors was decommissioned in 2010, and already plans were in place to upgrade them, to improve their sensitivity by about tenfold. Now, improvement in sensitivity or signal to noise ratio directly implies that you are increasing the volume outreach by 10 times in sensitivity implies 1,000 times improvement in volume. So the chances of seeing, so if you imagine that these sources are very few but spread evenly, the chances of finding something would also increase by the same amount, right? So the reach of the first generation of detectors would not have been enough to go all the way up to 400 odd like megaparsecs.
So it's
an amazing coincidence. Actually, the detector, the run of the second generation detectors was planned to start on 40, but the calibration team wanted to do some last minute changes, as so it was decided to postpone it by a few days, but luckily everything was still running. And it's just kindness, I suppose.
So, how many wells did you detect? Is the question. So, what I'm asking is that, did you detect after 14? It's just one time detection, right? And I'm asking is that, how many waves are coming from these distant black holes? Is it one wave or several waves? If there are several waves, why are the stars
answered only just the first part? Alright, so we have announced the discovery of one gravitational wave event. We expect that with the as the detectors are commissioned, because this is just the beginning of the second phase of LIGO, as the detectors go through the commissioning phase, the sensitivity will keep improving.
So the factor of 10 doesn't happen on the very first day. So what happens is it goes through a cycle of commissioning. So every after every few months of observation, it shut down, and then more things are added to it, more bells and whistles. So it takes about a year, more than a year, to basically get to the desired sensitivity. So we are already started seeing gravitational wave with better, more sensitivity improvements. I'm sure we'll see more. Does that answer your question? Okay, so replication as in, like, we would like to see more. Okay, so there are many sources which emit gravitational waves. This is just one of them. So as the sensitivity improves, we are, you know, keeping our eyes and ears open. So we will see what comes up.
So just a just one in queue. Can we?
Yeah, so I had two questions. First question was that while, like, this was one particular event, and each, like, any event that is happening, it radiates in all directions. So, but there are multiple, like, let's say that at the center of our galaxy, we have a black hole, or something like that. So, shouldn't we continuously be receiving some waveforms or the other?
That's very, very excellent question, actually. So, yes, we do expect, but these are frequency dependent. So, there is what is called a background of gravitational waves. Stochastic background, so just random gravitational waves in every direction, no matter where, in which direction you look at. It could be coming from the very early universe as well as from the confusion of so many sources. Right? So, when you go to very low frequencies, there is in fact a noise source because there are too many sources, too many white dwarf binaries which are emitting such waves, and you cannot resolve them. Luckily, in the band that we are operating, there is no
such. So the second question was that so we had earlier method, like we had earlier instruments of detecting, like telescopes, X-ray telescopes, and all those. So what advantage does a gravitational wave detector give us? Like we already knew black holes existed.
So we knew that black holes existed. We have seen indications of black holes. So while black holes themselves cannot emit any radiation, things that are falling into the black holes get heated up enough that they start emitting radiation because these ions, I mean, these plasma, they get accelerated and they start emitting all sorts of things. But so indirect evidence was there. So also Chandra, and, has been Chandra X-rays detector has already seen many of these things. So there were black hole candidates, but the direct detection was not there. Having said that, see, the light that you get from astrophysical objects is basically an incoherent sum of atomic, transitions, atomic vibrations, if you want to call it that. So, basically an incoherent sum of things that are happening at a very, very small scale. Whereas gravitational waves is basically, it's coming from the bulk motion of objects themselves. So, very different thing, you know, like the information that you're getting from black hole is very different from the information that light of any sort. So if you can combine these two, if you can see the same object in light as well as in gravitational wave, you can combine them to get an amazing, astronomy. So it's like, you watch TV with your sound closed and then you suddenly switch on the sound. You can, it's a completely different experience. Right? It's something like that.
I have a question, like with millions of bodies in the, space, and then each have its own gravitational waves, right? And then when you study, I suppose, like it's a super, they follow the principle of superposition. Then how do you make sure that this is from those two black holes?
So they do superpose and all those things happen, but they interact very weakly. So but still you can make sense of the data.
Yeah, so far, so something which is nearby will be making more sense when you measure. So then you went so far to measure, why didn't you measure sun, let's say, and...
Very good question again. So sun, and for instance the sun and earth system or the earth-moon system would also emit gravitational waves. Any dynamics of masses will emit gravitational waves. If I wave my hand, I am actually creating gravitational waves, perhaps more than somebody else who would want to wave his hand.
So it's very complex.
But
so how
the
do you
point being that they are very faint. So even if you can do this calculation if you're interested, if you take two, say, Maruti 800 cars, put them 1 meter apart and rotate them at a fantastic speed of 1,000 rotations per minute or whatever, you would still, you know, it would still be nowhere near the sensitive detection level. So you can think of space-time as a very, very stiff spring. So what happens is you have to put in a lot of energy to make a little dent in that spring. Okay? So you need fantastic objects, like very massive objects moving nearly the speed of light, to create that sort of an energy which would make the dent, which would be measurable by your detectors. That's
it. All right, so one last question. Anand, I'm referring to the noise that you saw on those on the chirp signal, and I'm coming from an engineering background, so I'm trying to take away something that I can give to the engineering community, the electronics guys, basically. So that signal originates from the way I see it, is a phase modulation that's resulting because of the spiraling of these two massive bodies, and that's the wave that's propagating at the speed of light. Now, while it travels through space, there are other rotating bodies, as we've been discussing, that could also add additional incoherent phase modulations to that signal. So, would that be the fundamental noise limit if you ignore all detector noise and stability and seismic noise? Would that be also a source of noise in the main signal?
Low frequencies, yes, it would. And in fact, for MESA, which is a sensitive, which with the targeted sensitivity, the confusion because of a lot of white dwarf binaries in our galaxy is actually a major source of noise. And you'll be able to not only not resolve, but also be able to see other things in that band where they all lie together. But what happens is they are, the mass is completely determined at what frequencies these objects come into the sensitive band of your detector. So yes, it is possible that first of all, these events are very rare. I mean, if you really look at even the fact that you're only able to go up to half a megaparsec, about 500 megaparsec, the number of events in this volume would not be very large to basically have this confusion noise and frequency of interest. But at low frequencies, yes, it could be a source of major.
All right, so let's wrap up this evening by thanking both speakers for nice talks. And there's some tea and refreshments outside, so you can always help yourself to that. So thanks very much for coming.
Could be coming from the very early universe as well as from the confusion of so many sources. Right. So when you go to very low frequencies, there is in fact a noise source. Because there are too many sources, too many white dwarf binaries which are emitting such waves, and you cannot resolve them. Luckily, in the band that we are operating, there is no such
thing. So the second question was that, so we had earlier method, like we had earlier instruments of detecting like telescopes, X-ray telescopes and all those. So what advantage does a gravitational wave detector give us? Like we already knew black holes existed.
So we knew that black holes existed. We have seen indications of black holes. So while black holes themselves cannot emit any radiation, things that are falling into the black holes get heated up enough that they start emitting radiation, because these ions, these the plasma, they get accelerated and they start emitting all sorts of things. But so indirect evidence was there. So also Chandra and has for instance Chandra X-rays. There were black hole candidates, but the direct detection was not there. Having said that, see, the light that you get from astrophysical objects is basically an incoherent sum of atomic transitions, essentially. Atomic vibrations, if you want to call it that. So basically an incoherent sum of things that are happening at a very, very small scale. Whereas gravitational waves is basically it's coming from the bulk motion of objects themselves. So very different thing. Like the information that you're getting from black hole is very different from the information that you get from light of any sort. So if you can combine these two, if you can see the same object in light as well as in gravitational wave, you you know, you watch TV with your sound closed, and then you suddenly switch on the sound. You can, you know, it's a completely different experience. Right? It's something like that.
I have a question, like with millions of bodies in the, you know, space, and then each have its own gravitational waves, right? And then when you study, I suppose, like it's a super, they follow the principle of superposition. Then how do you make sure that this is from those two black holes?
So they do superpose and all those things happen, but they interact very weakly. So by still you can make sense of the data.
Yeah, so far. So something which is nearby will be making more sense when you measure. So then you went so far to measure, why didn't you measure sun, let's say? And
very good question again. So sun, and what's in the Sun and Earth system, or the Earth-Moon system, would also emit gravitational waves. Any dynamics of masses will emit gravitational waves. If I wave my hand, I am actually creating gravitational waves, perhaps more than, you know, somebody else who would want to wave his hand.
So it's very complex.
But
how
the point being that they are very faint. Okay, so even if I, you can do this calculation if you're interested, if you take two, say, Maruti 800 cars, put them 1 meter apart, and rotate them at a fantastic speed of 1,000 rotations per minute or whatever, you would still, you know, it would still be nowhere near the sensitive detection level. So you can think of space-time as a very, very stiff spring. So what happens is you have to put in a lot of energy to make a little dent in that spring. Okay? So you need fantastic objects, like very massive objects moving nearly the speed of light, to create that sort of an energy which would make the dent. That's
all right. So one last question.
Anand, I'm referring to the noise that you saw on those on the chirp signal, and I'm coming from an engineering background, so I'm trying to take away something that I can give to the engineering community, the electronics guys, basically. So that signal originates from the way I see it, is a phase modulation that's resulting because of the spiraling of these two massive bodies. And that's the wave that's propagating at the speed of light. Now, while it travels through space, there are other rotating bodies, as we've been discussing, that could also add additional incoherent phase modulations to that signal. So would that be the fundamental noise limit if you ignore all detector noise and stability and seismic noise? Would that be also a source of noise in the main signal?
Low frequencies, yes, it would. In fact, for MESA, which is a sensitive, which with the targeted sensitivities are very low, at low frequencies of about 3 Hz or so, the confusion because of a lot of white dwarf binaries in our galaxy is actually a major source of noise. And you'll be able to not only not resolve, but also be able to see other things in that band where they all lie together. But what happens is they are. Mass is completely determined at what frequencies these objects come into the sensitive band of your detector. So yes, it is possible that, first of all, these events are very rare. I mean, if you really look at this thing, I mean, even the fact that you're only able to go up to half a, you know, about 500 megaparsec, the number of events in this volume would not be very large to basically have this kind of
all right, so let's wrap up this evening by thanking both speakers for nice talks. And there's some tea and refreshments outside, so you can always help yourself to that. So thanks very much for coming.
It's related to this discovery. So while you're having your tea and snacks, please feel free to just, you know, go through the posters and encourage the students. Thanks.